So Sarah, we're curious, where do you envision youth ministry? What do you see 5 years out if the Joy in Human Flourishing project succeeds in forming a movement?
Boy, I think three things. One is dynamism, just this dynamic interchange between what's happening inside the church and what's happening outside the church. And like you said earlier, where the lines are really blurred in regard to whose children, thinking about this with the so dynamism. The second thing would be intergenerational, mm-hmm. Because what I realized is that ministry is never just to the youth; is always to the family and the family cycle, the cycles that families have lived through. Intergenerational ministry becomes a place where the past, present, and future really come together, you know. So intergenerational dynamic and then holistic, mm-hmm. Where the body, spirit, emotional, social, you know, all of that is being ministered to, where you're dealing with issues around social capital, where advocacy comes alive because you realize that you're not just ministering to the spirit of youth, but you're also ministering to their everyday needs. And so that type of advocacy comes to life. And I just keep thinking about this image of me growing up where I was, you know, my mom, I grew up in a Christian home. My mom was a single mother, grew up in a Christian home, so I was deeply committed to faith. But I realized that one of the major kind of things that also saved my life was a community center that was from a Presbyterian, out of the Philadelphia Presbytery. Wasn't built to be a worshiping body. It was built to be a community center. It was a gathering space in the community, and I went there often. And through that program where I learned about drama, art, and all these other kind of cultural enrichment opportunities, there was this old Quaker woman who was in her 80s. And I remember her distinctly. I was moving through elementary, middle school there, and I was headed into high school, and she was telling me about this program called Upward Bound. And I remember her telling me that she went down to the office, and they had already had all their applicants for the year. And she went and stamped kind of in, knocked on the door of the director of Upward Bound and said, "No, you're gonna admit this girl. You need to admit her." And you know, even though he had selected all his students, looking at this old white Quaker woman who was there advocating for me, saying, "No, you have to create access, you have to create space," he admitted me into the program. And just thinking about that access to college and being, you know, being able to kind of be prepared in other kinds of ways. When I think about youth ministry, I think about that intergenerational connection where a white Quaker woman can go and advocate for this black inner city girl who really had no idea about this world that I was about to come into with college. And you know, and I think about the dynamism of me being able to come in and out of this space that was a worshiping, that wasn't set to be a worshiping body, but was really doing the work of God. God was intervening. The Holy Spirit was working in that space because committed Christians and even people who weren't Christians had decided that this community, this small community, was very important and it mattered. Mm-hmm. And then just thinking about that holistic piece, that it wasn't just about me being ministered to learning about Jesus, but it was also about caring about my education and about me being able to read, that those things mattered in my ability to flourish. Mm-hmm.